Please be seated and see how prayer can make a difference.
Hi, my name is Deborah Lamb. I am the director of Stand at the Crossroads Ministries. We have two houses, one called My Father's House, and we have another house with three apartments called Crossroads Community, and that's for women with children that we are trying to help. Now, I'm here to talk a little bit today about prayer and how important it is in our ministry. Right at the beginning, I knew that prayer was going to be a vital part of our ministry. I began to ask people to pray for me when I even began to think about it. And then as I started going on, I asked my church to be behind me in prayer, if anything that they could be praying for me. I was to speak at the Katie Williams Sunday School class. And as I was praying and thinking about what I wanted to share with them, I just felt like God was saying, ask them to pray. And I thought, well, what better ladies to ask to pray than these ladies that have had so many life experiences and know what women go through. And so that's what I did, and they were all so enthusiastic about it. I began to send a prayer sheet once a month to let them know what the prayer requests were for the ministry and for the ladies. And then I got so excited about having them pray, I began to send the same prayer requests to other people that became interested in our praying for us, and to the churches, some churches around the area. We have had three ladies give their lives to Christ and be baptized this year. Not only that, but at the beginning when I started working with women and children, I was mainly focusing on the women. But this year, three of our children gave their lives to Christ, and two of them were baptized. And that is just so awesome to me, to think that God looks beyond my little dream. When I began this ministry, I just thought, oh, this is cool. I'll just have a little house and I'll have people stay there. I didn't know the enormous need. I didn't understand what was going to be required of me or of just the community of faith getting involved. But God did, and He just has orchestrated it. Far beyond, one of my favorite verses, that God can do exceedingly abundantly beyond all that we ask or even imagine, according to His power that works within us. I would ask St. John's to continue to pray for us, just that as a ministry, as the board, as the directors, that we would be going in the direction He wants us to go into. This has different avenues that we could go into. We definitely want to pay our property off this year. We owe $50,000 and get that paid off. We want to build more units, because I'm getting phone calls every day for women who have children and need a place to stay. And it's just so hard for me to say, we're fulled up, I can't help you. And I see that need getting greater and greater. So for that, God to expand our ministry, to minister to more women, to minister to more children, and then have the wisdom as we work with these ladies, because we aren't just a ministry contained in itself. We use the whole community of faith in our area, Acts and Christ Central and other churches. And St. John's is such a vital part of our ministry, with the people here that give and the Sunday school classes here that come alongside us at different times of the year when we have needs.
Our scripture lesson comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the third chapter, verses 13 and following. Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. And John would have prevented him, saying, I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me? But Jesus answered him, let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness. And then he consented. And when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and sitting on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my Son, my beloved, in whom I am well pleased. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Not only have we lost two wonderful saints this week. Both of them were members of this church for over 60 years. May Croth was our church treasurer for the last 25 years. Miss Ruth was a part of so many circles and activities and social activities. They both were a part of fellowship Sunday school class. They truly were saints, and they will be missed. But there were one thing they were. They were baptized. And as baptized children of God, they are living together today with the one who claimed them by name. One who claimed them in their baptism. And they forever are living with God. I also have a personal request of prayer today. Friday morning, I received early Friday morning a telephone call. My mentor and my second dad passed away. He had been a Baptist minister for over 60 years and was just serving until a few weeks ago. He was in his 80s. Out of the little Baptist church I grew up in, there were four ministers. One was Ed Griggs, my mentor and my second dad. The second was Ernest Wimber. And the fourth was Grover Johnson. And the third was George Al. At a time when I was struggling through college and seminary, at a time when I was stumbling and didn't even believe in myself, Ed Griggs believed in me. He stood with me. He believed in me until I could believe in myself. Not only was he my mentor, he was my second father. And throughout all of these years, he has been in touch with me and I have been in touch with him. And I want you to pray for Betty, his wife, and he had no children because I was his son. And that's the way I became his son. So please pray for them today. I'm leaving right after the worship service this morning. The service is at 3 o'clock in Hartsville, and I am officiating at that service. It's going to be a great joy, but please be in prayer for me today. John the Baptist began his ministry in the wilderness, in the desert, on the banks of the Jordan River. And great crowds came to hear him preach. But John the Baptist did not make it comfortable or easy for them to hear him. In fact, John the Baptist went out of the way to make it uncomfortable. John the Baptist didn't go to them. They had to come to him. And they had to travel a long distance on foot through the wilderness. Under the heat of the hot desert sun. And when they arrived at the Jordan, it was as if John made no preparation for the crowds whatsoever. Oh, there were no comfortable pews. There was not even one single hard rock for them to stand on. There was not even any food. There wasn't even any Methodist fellowship supper. And one thing you can be sure of, there was no short sermons. No short 20-minute sermons, these positive, uplifting sermons that make us feel good about ourselves. No! John the Baptist preached just the opposite. Hell, fire, and brimstone. And when all those great crowds came before him, he stood up and said, "You're going to hell. All of you. Every single one of you is going to hell, and you will burn with unquenchable fire." Well, that wouldn't go over very well today, would it? It wouldn't go over very well with the sensibilities of our culture today, with our tolerance and acceptance. Why, preaching like that might offend someone. It might turn someone away. Why, it would even offend our sensibilities in this church today. Think about it. If someone stood in this pulpit and said to you, you're going to hell. Every last single one of you will burn. That person wouldn't last very long in this pulpit, would he? And John the Baptist as a preacher wouldn't last very long in the pulpits of America today. John the Baptist said, you are not fit for the kingdom of God. The pulpits of the day, the message of the day is, God loves you just the way you are. Today's message is, you're good. Folks, you're good, decent people. At the very core of who you are decent people trying to do your best. Oh, you might mess up and make a little tiny mistake here and there, but that's usually someone else's fault. You're basically good. John the Baptist said, no, you're nothing but a brood of vipers and snakes. Who in the world warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Why are you coming out to this wilderness? The message of the day says God is love. God is pure love. He's non-judgmental. Why, God would never judge anybody. God would never send anyone to hell because He's love. God loves us just the way we are. John the Baptist said, no. Folks, you're in need of a Savior. You're in need of a Savior. You're going down the wrong road, and if you don't turn around and go another road, you're going to lead to destruction. What you need is a Savior. What you need is to fall on your knees and repent and come into these cold waters of the Jordan and have your sins washed away, and then you prepare and open your heart for the coming of God. John the Baptist said that's the only way you're ever going to change. John the Baptist said, you can't change until you recognize who you are. A sinner. Broken. Estranged from God. And the only way you're going to be able to receive God in your life is to repent. We live in a culture today that doesn't understand that word, repent. Have you ever seen anyone so stubborn, so hard-headed, I'm not talking about me, that they never said, I'm sorry? Do you ever have seen anyone who was so stubborn, so certain that they were right, they never said, I was wrong? Have you ever seen anyone who was so stubborn and set in their way, even if they knew it, they would never, ever admit, and they believed that they were always right? Maybe some of you are married to someone like that. Even God can't change a heart like that. We're in need of a Savior. And the only way is to ask for forgiveness. John the Baptist came with hope. And he said to all those great crowds, there is hope for you. That's the reason they traveled so far to hear him. If you would just repent, open up your heart to God, and the Savior will come. Now, there were many people who thought that John the Baptist was the Savior. And they asked him, are you the Christ? And he said, oh, no, 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 no. Not me. But there's one coming. And he? Well, I'm not even worthy to touch the thong of his sandals. He's in a total different league than myself. For you see, I baptize you with water, but He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit, and He will baptize you with fire. And then one day, Jesus came. to be baptized by John. Now, when John saw Jesus, he said, "Lord, I can't baptize you." He refused. "I need to be baptized by you." And Jesus answered and said, "Oh, no, 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 no. This is right and it's fitting. It's necessary to fulfill all righteousness." So why did Jesus come to be baptized by John? Because to me, it seems so unnecessary. Jesus was without sin, blameless and holy Son of God. He was above sin. Never sin. Why did he have to submit to John's baptism, a baptism of remission of sins? Well, it's because Jesus wanted to identify with us. A few years ago when I was in Kenya, on the first day of our conference, we had over 200 ministers from about 30-some different denominations that were present there. And every morning, beginning on the first morning at 10 o'clock, there was tea. And at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, there was high tea. It didn't matter what we were doing, where we were, at 10 o'clock we stopped and we had tea. At 4 o'clock we stopped and we had tea. So the first morning at 10 o'clock, all the people got up and left for tea. And the host of the conference came to all of us who came to America and directed us into this very fancy room. And they had this silver teapots with their best china spread all around. Those silver little teaspoons. And Dick McLean, the leader of our group, said, "Oh no, this will not do." And the host thought they had done something wrong. And Dick McLean said, "Where are the others having tea?" He said, "Oh, they're outside in the courtyard under the hot sun." And Dick McLean said, "That's where we'll have tea." And what I discovered, and they weren't around a teapot. This was a big old steel pot with about 10 gallons of tea in it. And we waited last to be served. And oftentimes the tea was already gone before we got there. But I knew that it was around the teapot, going and talking to minister after minister. You see, when Dick McLean was right, when we became like them, they opened up their hearts to us. And the people and the ministers that I met are still my friends today. We had to become like them so that they would open up their hearts to us. That's the reason God sent Jesus in the first place. His birth meant that God came to be with us, to identify with us and who we are. Jesus was born of a woman. And he felt the pains and the hurts of all of us. Why, he even knew what it was to stump his toe. He knew what it was to feel the joy of a cool breeze. He understood what it was to work for a living and to learn a trade in the carpentry shop and to earn a living with his very own hands. And when he stepped into the cold Jordan River, he identified with us. He understood our pain and our hurt and our sorrows, our regrets and our sin. And there in the Jordan River, he took our sins upon himself. You see, Jesus' baptism in the Jordan River reminds me of the baptism of his death. His death on the cross. Do you see Jesus' love in the River Jordan? His love on the cross when he died for the sins of the whole world, for you and for me. Jesus went into the River Jordan so that he might be like us, so that one day we will be like him. Don't let that word pass you by, please. Jesus came to be like us so that we might become like him. On the day that Jesus was baptized, the Spirit came down and it sat on him like a dove. And there was a voice coming out of heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." God said to everyone that could hear, "This is my Son. I love him. He's part of me." At every baptism that I conduct, I ask the parents, the mother or the father, "What name is given this child?" And they give the name. And do you know that the name is the same for every child? Christ. Christian. And when every child is baptized, the Holy Spirit comes down. Now, you may not see it. You may not even perceive it. But it's here. The Holy Spirit comes and seals this child, bonds this child. And God said, "This is my Son. This is my daughter. They belong to me. They're part of my family." RJ is my son. And from the first time I held him in my arms, there was this bond. There was this unbreakable seal that nothing in this world could break it. Now, RJ's a good kid. So far, he's done pretty good. He's a typical teenage boy, but he's a good kid. If RJ goes out and he falls away, or if he does something that's not pleasing to me, I want you to know that when he comes back, there will be nothing in this world that won't prevent me from throwing my arms around him and saying to him, "You are my son. You are my son." That is the same way it is with Christ in our baptism. We aren't going to live holy. We're Methodist. We're not going to always be righteous. We're Methodist. I'm going to say a word that you haven't heard in a long time. Backsliding. We stumble. We fall. We fail. But there is a God, there is a seal, an unbreakable seal, and God from heaven calls out in a loud voice, "You are my son and you are my daughter." You see, baptism doesn't not only tell us who Christ is, baptism tells us who we are. We are sinners saved by grace. We are sinners redeemed by the love of God. Jesus went into the waters. He became like us so we could become like him, a son and a daughter of God. You are Christ. You are Christian. In a minute, I want you to come. This is not re-baptism. We are baptized once. Christ died once. We are baptized once. This is remembering your baptism. It's remembering who you are, a royal priesthood. Once you were no people, but now you are the people of God. But special people. Dip your hand in the water. Put the water on your forehead. Remember your baptism. And be thankful. We're about to hear a beautiful song. And during this song, I invite you to come as you are led by the Spirit. Please, come to the waters of your baptism.